Hi, my name is Linda, and I just want to say thank you for sharing your work and your history with myself. I have a few questions, particularly to Gina, but definitely to the entire panel. I noticed, actually, I'm going to start with my very first question, so actually not about Gina. But the Jewish Refugee Action Network that sort of birthed here days ago or so, you were saying, to what extent will Roma be a part of this particular network, and how can other Canadians contribute to sort of making sure that this type of hate doesn't take place here?
The birth of JRAN, which is actually, and I'm sure there's some JRAN members here who are kind of like slinking their seats, thinking FARBER, we were not supposed to really announce this until next week, and we're going to have a big press conference there. You heard it here first at Holy Plaza. So that's the way things should be. It was born out of a result of how the issue with the Roma was being dealt with here in Canada. And we've been working very closely with Gina and others in the community, and immigration lawyers, refugee lawyers, and its impetus really was as a result of the Roma refugee issue. But let's not lose sight, it's not just the Roma. There are issues with Mexican refugees, and there are issues with refugees from Ghana and from other countries. It is only prevalent, and the issue really became very public in terms of the Roma. And it became ridiculously public in terms of the Roma because our Minister of Immigration made it so. And so, you know, we will spread out, and we will do as much as we can. We have, you know, doctors are involved, and lawyers are involved, and jurors are involved, and you know, it's really going to be, I think, an action network for refugees in general. And all I can ask you to do at this point is keep your eyes and ears open, and when you see the announcement, and there will be a website that you can go to, and there will be ways to contribute in 100 different manners, please be there and contribute any way that we ask.
Thank you. I hope that it will become open to the wider community. Absolutely. I feel very passionate about this issue. My next question is for Gina. What can we, as the Canadian public, do to support your community center? Having been there, I know that, you know, you guys are in need, and what can we do to help you, and where can we go to do so?
Well, the first way that people can help is, it's quite obvious, it's actually, you know, as a volunteer-based organization, it would help if we had paid staff. So we have, you know, a way to donate on our website at the www.romatoronto.org and the Family Sustainer Program that we just established just a few days ago on our website, where people can make reoccurring $10 or $20 a month donations and receive a tax receipt at the end of the year. So obviously being able to have paid staff makes a big difference in helping the community. A community that has such a huge amount of distrust, it helps when they can go to an organization that is specifically Romani based, where people understand them, where we're speaking their language, where we have people speaking Romanes, where there's that welcoming and that comfort and that feeling of belonging. And being you know, a sole Canadian Roma organization doing this work, it can really exemplify the limited resources available for Roma in Canada when there's this tiny little organization with just volunteer staff. It's our little tiny bit of help that we can give to the community coming, and the advocacy that we're doing is certainly something that all Canadians can help with. So when you're hearing these negative gypsy stereotypes, you know, being spoken in different sectors or communities or different spheres of our life here in Canada, to address them and say, well, you don't know what's actually the truth then about the gypsy people that you speak of. You know, people often look at the symptoms of years of, you know, discrimination and marginalization and think that that's actually part of the culture, when in fact it's not. It's, you know, a place that people ended up in. Nobody chooses to beg. Nobody chooses that life for themselves. And what I've witnessed in Europe is people have been forced into that situation in order to survive. And Roma have become the professional recyclers in Europe of recycling metal, of finding anything that could be fixed and resold, as finding a way to eke out an income for the majority of the people. So really helping to address the stereotypes and that some may hold as well as others is a big first step. And then secondly, really, you know, as was mentioned, writing letters or making phone calls, we don't have the capacity to address all of the things where we find you know, very negative images about us. And so it's important to have a greater voice working in unison. And thirdly, you know, I think that we have a way to have our voices heard by who we elect. And so speaking to our MPPs or our MPs, voicing your concern about why there's thousands of people among us that don't seem to deserve basic health care. Voicing our concerns of why people are escaping very well documented racially motivated violence and coming to Canada to seek safety, and they're being humiliated here by these negative stereotypes. So those are some of the small things that and meaningful things that people could do to help us.
So we'll take one final question.
It's a quick question that really is not going to be a quick answer. What's life like in the Roma community and feeling these days?
Exceptionally bad. Unfortunately, it's a country that had originally been relatively kind to the Roma, but no longer. I don't know whether you've seen the film footage of the Roma camps being burnt down in Italy. Yes. So things have really deteriorated. But I've spoken with some of the Roma there, and one of the advantages, one of the few advantages they actually have in Italy is they can blend into the population. If they don't stick out as they do in, yes, you know, dark hair, you could be. Are you sure you're not Italian?
What part of it?
No, I mean, you do see what I mean. And they do have that advantage. But otherwise, life is really the best.
This is for Anna Porter. I appreciate that you talked about the Conservative Party and Jason Kenney, who you know. I was wondering whether you have any hopes that there will be a change in policy.
A very short answer, yes. Yes, I really do think that, you know, if we, enough of us raise our voices, and I have spoken with him on several occasions, as has, yes. So, yeah, I do believe that that there's a very good chance.
Thank you.
Let me just add one more thing, because I told you I'm going to give you all homework tonight, and I was serious. There's about, oh, I don't know, 150 people here in the room tonight. Put up your hand if you have access to a computer. Okay, most of you do. I'd like each of you to go home and do one of two things. Either write a letter to the editor saying that you were here tonight. I don't care. Choose a newspaper. It doesn't matter. And it doesn't matter even if your letter gets printed or not. If all of a sudden the Toronto Star gets 80 letters about a Roma event that happened at Holy Blossom, they're going to start opening their eyes and wondering what's going on. But better yet, write to your MP, or write to Jason Kenney. Could you imagine if Jason Kenney tomorrow got 150 letters about this event? It's not hard to do. You just go in front of your computer and type in Jason Kenney, you'll get his email address, and type your letter and send it. It'll take you 3.5 minutes. I really urge you to do that. One last thing, somebody was asking me who the architect was, and I didn't mention his name. It was Daniel Liebeskind. I apologize.
Not the Star, the Post, the National Post.
Right.